Right, so this is a continuation really of the last lesson. Still looking at factoring trinomials from the same section of the textbook, but slightly more involved questions. Essentially questions when we have this coefficient in front of the x squared that we can't just factor out nicely. And the only time we were able to factor something like this yesterday was when, and it wasn't a lot of examples, is when you had some coefficient in the front that you could factor out of everything. You know, it was the greatest common factor, and then apply what we looked at last day. So if you look in this case, there's a 10 in front of the x squared, and I can't take a factor of 10 out of everything. So what can I do? Well, it's going to be a bit more involved, but it's the only thing we're going to look at. So the first thing I want to do, because again, our job in the end is to try to get to, you know, a pair of factors. X plus or minus something, x plus or minus something here. But I know there's also going to be a coefficient. If it's just x plus some number and x plus some number, you know, when I FOIL this out, the first thing I do is go x times x is x squared. But there's 10x squared here. So, you know, at least one of these must have a coefficient. Maybe this is 10x. Maybe this is 5 and this is a 2. Maybe there's so many possibilities. And again, we don't just want to do guess and check. So what can we do? Well, the first thing is pay attention to the first and the last coefficients, assuming it's written in this sort of general form, and multiply them together. And we get 10 times 3 is positive 30. So now you have to think to yourself, okay, what are two integers that multiply to positive 30? And I also have to think about two integers, the same two integers, that add to negative 17. So the same sort of steps we have to think about, although there's still going to be several more steps after this. But first, I multiply the 10 and the 3 together and think, what are two numbers that multiply to 30 but add to negative 17? Now, eventually, when I think about, you know, if you think there isn't a possibility, if there are no two numbers in this case that multiply to 30 and add to negative 17, that means either you cannot factor it, which happens sometimes, or more likely, you've just missed something. Okay, in this case, two numbers that multiply to 30 but add to negative 17 are negative 15 and negative 2. So negative 15 times negative 2 is positive 30. Negative 15 plus negative 2 is negative 17. But those are not my factors. What I do now is I take that negative 17x and I break it up into two terms. I uncollect like terms, I guess you could say. And one of them is going to be negative 15x and one is negative 2x. It doesn't matter what order I write them. And so those two integers that I mentioned here and here are the, in fact, I'll highlight these all the same color, are the same integers that I break that middle term up into. So I'll just make this a bit neater. Oh, helps if I could write properly. Negative 15x, negative 2x. Okay, that's it. The rest of it, for now, I'm just gonna leave alone. So plus 3 over here, 10x squared. So notice what I've done. And a good question is, why have I done this? Well, obviously, I'll get to that. But I've taken 10x squared minus 17x plus 3, and I've, in a sense, made it more complex. I've broken it up into four terms instead of three. But remember, when you're factoring, you're unfoiling. And when you're foiling two binomials, at some point, you usually get four terms, and then you collect like terms to get your final answer. Well, I've kind of uncollected my like terms here. So now what I need to do is factor by grouping, which we reviewed, or actually were introduced to, a couple of lessons ago. So if I look at these four terms, if I break them up into pairs and find the greatest common factor of each pair, for example, in the first pair, the greatest common factor is 5x. If I take out a factor of 5x from there, I have 2x minus 3. If I look in the next two terms, the ones I've highlighted, sorry, I've underlined in blue, the greatest common factor of that, well, there doesn't seem to be any. Well, you can always take out a 1 or a negative 1. In this case, if I take out a factor of negative 1, that means I'm dividing everything underlined in blue by negative 1. That negative 2x becomes positive 2x. That positive 3 becomes negative 3. And notice what I have are now the same factor here and here. And this should sound familiar. Again, this is going to be one of the tougher lessons of this unit. But we saw this two lessons ago at the end of the lesson on factoring by finding the greatest common factor. These two fairly messy terms have a binomial common factor, so we call this factoring by grouping. So now I take out that common factor of 2x minus 3, and we usually write it first, although again, we don't have to. And then every time you pull out a factor, you're really dividing each of these. You know, in this case, I'm dividing this by 2x minus 3. I'm dividing this by 2x minus 3. And so notice, when when I take out that factor of 2x minus 3, what am I left with? I'm left with 5x take away 1. And that's my factored solution. And notice, if I look at this and I FOIL it out, you know, if I went 1, 2, 3, 4 steps, that would bring me to here. Collect like terms, that brings you to there. Yes, it's definitely more difficult doing this backwards. This is about as complex. In fact, this is, you know, essentially as complex as it gets in this course for factoring. And so I'll never ask you to do lots of these. Your homework, you don't have dozens upon dozens of these. But we do need definitely a bit of practice. And without some practice, this lesson is meaningless. And so honestly, like I've always said, you know, everything builds upon one lesson builds upon the previous one. Until we have the previous lesson down and proficient with that, this lesson is meaningless. But once we have that down, then we can start to, you know, have a chance to kind of grasp this. But it really depends on first feeling confident with the last lesson, which is the more important one. Again, don't think the harder things are more important. And we have to build upon the more direct. And the last lesson is simpler. We were able to factor those trinomials much faster than this. With that said, though, that's one example. Let's do a few more. Let's look at these two. 2x squared minus x minus 6. And keep in mind, that's like a coefficient of minus 1 right there. So the first thing I want to do is realize there is no GCF. I can't take a factor of 2 out. So if I could, I would want to do that right away, and this would be a lot easier. But I can't, so I want to multiply 2 and negative 6 together and get negative 12. And I want to think of two numbers that multiply to negative 12 and add to negative 1. Well, the only two numbers that will work are negative 4 and positive 3. So I'm going to break up negative 1x to negative 4x and positive 3x. And I can write those in any order. It won't matter. So 2x squared over here, take away 6. Next, I want to factor by grouping. Look at this pair and look at this pair. And it's essential I take out the greatest common factor of each. Otherwise, this won't work. The greatest common factor of what I have underlined in red is 2x. Take out a common factor of 2x. I'm left with x minus 2. Okay, so my goal for what's underlined in blue is to take out a factor. So I'm also left with x minus 2. And in this case, if I take out a factor of 2, sorry, not 2, take that back, 2 is not a common factor, 3 is. Take out a common factor of 3 from both, which is the greatest common factor. I'm left with just x minus 2 there as well. And as soon as I notice I have the same factor for both, that means I'm on the right track. And essentially, I'm done. Because now I have my greatest common factor of x minus 2. I want to take that factor out. Usually, again, we write it first, but you don't have to. And once I take out that common factor of x minus 2, what's left? 2x plus 3. So now that we've done one example, I can go through it faster, but it's never going to be that fast. Like I said, I'm never going to ask you to do lots and lots of these. And again, if you're ever unsure, go 1, 2, 3, 4. It should bring you to this step, which should bring you to this step if you look at it backwards. But yes, it takes a bit of time to check. But like I said, you will have time. And so it's not a bad idea to check these things. Okay, let's look at this one. Same idea. I don't have a greatest common factor that I can take out. So let's start with going 2 times 3, which is positive 6. Two numbers that multiply to positive 6 and add to negative 5. Those two numbers are negative 2 and negative 3. So negative 2x, negative 3x. A common mistake is to think, for example, negative 6 and positive 1 will work. Well, negative 6 plus 1 does equal negative 5, but negative 6 times 1 is not positive 6, it's negative 6. Like I said, if it's going to work, there's only ever one correct pair. That's it, plus 3 and a 2x squared here. Again, now I want to factor by grouping, looking at this separately. First two terms, the greatest common factor is 2 and x together, 2x. Take out a common factor of 2x, I have x minus 1. Remember, 2x divided by 2x is 1, not 0. Okay, looking over, it's underlined in blue. The greatest common factor, I could take out a positive 3, but notice if I take out a positive 3, I'm going to be left with negative x plus 3. Sorry, negative x plus 1, I meant to write down. However, that doesn't do me any good, because what I have here and here is not the same. X minus 1 and minus x plus 1 are different, which means I'm stuck. And I haven't so much made a mistake, but that factor of positive 3 I took out wasn't helpful, but will be helpful if I take out a factor of minus 3, because that will change the sign of both those. Take out a factor of negative 3, I have positive x, take away 3. Oh, I keep throwing that 3 down, take away 1. What I've done twice now in a row is a common mistake. I've caught it, but it is a common mistake when you take out a factor to forget to take it out from both. But that's it, now I have my greatest common factor of x minus 1. Write that first, pull out that factor of x minus 1, and what's left? Just the 2x, take away 3. And again, I guarantee if you FOIL this out, you will get to this step here, collect like terms, you get to this step here. Okay, all I've left are two more kind of weird looking examples and then a final problem, which kind of leads us into the last lesson actually. Okay, let's look at this one next. Okay, X and Y's. Now that's it. Hopefully, after the last lesson, this isn't so daunting because we saw in the last lesson that if there's an X and a Y in it, we can still factor it as we normally would, just our factors will have both X and Y in them. So, essentially, don't get freaked out by the X and the Y. Start by multiplying 6 and 1 together, because the coefficient here is 1, which is positive 6, and find two numbers that multiply to positive 6 and negative 5. Well, I will say, we've been thinking about numbers like that a lot. That's, in this case, it's going to be, again, negative 2 and positive 3, negative 3. So plus y squared over here, and 6x squared. Again, every time, that first step is to find out how I'm going to uncollect those like terms, which again is not really a phrase, uncollecting like terms, but I'm breaking up that middle term. And again, two numbers that multiply to positive 6 and add to negative 5 have to be negative 2 and negative 3. Okay, so, oh, I wrote down one thing wrong. These would be xy. There we go. All right, so let's factor by grouping. Here and here. Really important as this gets a little bit more complex to make sure I'm finding the greatest common factor. In the first pair, the greatest common factor is 2x. They both don't have a y, so I can't take a y out of both. If I take out a factor of 2x, I'm left with 3x minus y. Okay, so that's my goal, to have a factor of 3x minus y from what's underlined in blue. Well, to do that, I can take a factor of y out, but if I take a factor of just positive y, I can see my signs won't match up. But if I take out a factor of negative y, then both my signs will change. So negative 3xy divided by negative y is positive 3x. Positive y squared divided by negative y is negative y. And so actually quite often, you know, roughly half the time, for this step right here, it'll be advantageous, it'll be kind of necessary to take out a negative factor instead of a positive. And you can always do that, it just hasn't really been helpful until now. And now the hardest part is definitely done. I got my common factor of 3x minus y, take that factor out, I'm left with 2x minus y. So in the end, the fact that there was a y and an x in this trinomial didn't really make any difference in terms of the amount of work. If it did make a difference, it just kind of, maybe it threw us off at the beginning. But it really is the same amount of work as before. And so similarly for this last example, for the final problem, if I have a power of 4 and then a power of 2 in the middle, it's going to be the same amount of work. And again, just my factors in the end are going to have t to the power of 2 at some point. And we saw something similar last day. That's it. Let's start doing the same thing. Multiply 10 and negative 6 together, negative 60. I think of two numbers that multiply to negative 60, but add to positive 11. Now, 60, I first think 6 and 10, but I can't make that add to 11. Eventually, we can realize that 15 and 4 will work. 15 times 4 is 60, and 15 take away 4 is 11. And so my two factors I want to use are positive 15t squared and negative 4t squared. That's it. Again, though, if we don't have a solid grasp on the stuff we've done before, I wouldn't even worry about this question right now. Okay, that's it. That's a big step done. Now, factor by grouping, here and here. So in the first pair, the greatest common factor is 5t squared, all of that. Take out a factor of 5t squared, I'm left with 2t squared plus 3. And again, my goal is to get that same factor from what's underlined in red. Well, if I take out a common factor of negative 2, I'm dividing each of those two terms that I've underlined in red by negative 2, I'm left with positive 2t squared plus 3, exactly as I want. So that means I know I'm correct, and so 2t squared plus 3, and I'm left with 5t squared minus 2. And so again, the fact there was t to the power 4 and t to the power of 2 in the middle term didn't really make a difference as long as we just, again, don't kind of scare ourselves. And again, both of these examples build upon things we saw from the very last video, the very last lesson, in which we saw very similar things with easier questions, I should say. And that leads me to the final problem, which again is coming back to a visual, and really this kind of leads us into the last lesson in this unit. So what I have here is the area of the circle. Let's remind ourselves how we find the area of a circle. Area of a circle is pi times radius squared. And there's the radius right there. So the area of this particular circle is 9 pi x squared minus 12 pi x plus 4 pi. All right, I want to find what is the radius of this circle. I've called it r right here, but in terms of this, in terms of x and all this, what is the radius? Okay, what I have off to the right is just a general formula for the area of any circle. So really, what's the radius of the circle knowing its area? Well, first, that means I have to somehow take this and make it look more like this. Okay, I have to see how the expression I gave you relates back to the formula for the area of a circle. One thing that should not be surprising is that factoring will come into play. This is all a lesson on factoring. And the first thing we should always check for when trying to factor is there a greatest common factor? And it's pretty messy here, but there is a greatest common factor. All three of these terms have a common factor of pi, which is a very important number, especially when dealing with circles. So if I take a common factor of pi out of here, I'm left with 9x squared minus 12x plus 4. All right, and so once I take that common factor of pi out, then what you have in here is a little more familiar looking. Now, what we could do is, and it's not wrong, is multiply 9 and 4 together and get 36, and find two numbers that multiply to 36 and add to negative 12, and then factor by grouping, and then you will see, you'll get two factors all times by pi, okay? And that's not a wrong idea at all. However, I know all of this represents the area of a circle, and notice the area of a circle is pi times the radius squared. Well, that means I know whatever I get here and here, it must be the same thing, because it's pi times the radius times itself, which means I know that these two factors have to be the same, which means I know that what you see highlighted in blue is a perfect square. And why is that important? Because it can save me a ton of work. Okay, I know this has to be a perfect square, which just means I know it must have the same factor twice. That's what a perfect square is. 25 is a perfect square because it's the same as 5 times 5, the same factor twice. So again, how is it helpful that this is a perfect square? Well, that means I don't actually have to do nearly as much work because I know whatever goes in these two blanks has to be the same. And I know if I FOIL it out, it should get what you see highlighted in blue up above, which means I know whatever term goes here and here has to multiply together to make 9x squared. So what times itself equals 9x squared? 3x. I know that has to be 3x. And whatever goes here and here has to multiply to make positive 4. So what number times itself equals positive 4? Well, 2 or negative 2. So at this point, I know there's going to be a 2 here. I just don't know if it's both going to be plus 2 or both be minus 2. Because again, negative 2 times negative 2 is also positive 4. Well, this is where I just look right here and I realize there's a negative here. So I know each of these must be negative. If they were positive, every term would be positive and everything up here would be positive. That's it. If you're not sure, just FOIL it out. You'll get this here. Or if you want, like I said, it's not a bad idea to go back to what we had right here and multiply the 9 and 4 together to get 36 and find two numbers that multiply to 36 and add to negative 12. But you'll go through several more steps to get to the same answer, where we have, again, the same factor twice, which again, I knew I must have because I knew by comparing this to the area of a circle that what's highlighted in blue must be the radius times itself. And so therefore, what's the radius? The radius is 3x minus 2, one of these factors, right? So the radius of this circle is 3x minus 2, just one of those, right? Pi times radius squared. Definitely a hard question. And like I said, the hardest questions are not the most important questions. But if we understand the basics, we can build upon that. And if we understand, you know, more than the basics, we can get to something like this. Okay, but it takes kind of a sequence to get there. And I'm